You're listening to the audio production of Worry Less, Live More, God's Prescription for a Better Life by Robert J. Morgan, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Maurice England.
Preface: How to Bury Worry Before Worry Buries You. Amazon keeps track of your highlights. When ebook owners mark sentences, the online retailer knows and notes it. Recently, Amazon released a list of the most popular passages in some of its best-selling books, such as The Hunger Games, the Harry Potter series, and Pride and Prejudice. Also released, the most highlighted passage in the Holy Bible. I expected America's favorite biblical portion to be John chapter 3, verse 16, Psalm 23, or the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 13. But no, it was a less prominent text, but one that's striking a deep chord in today's worried world. It was Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is a passage I've underscored in my own Bible, and it's a portion of a paragraph I've memorized from the book of Philippians. These words shore up my sanity, because I've battled anxiety from childhood. I have a journal full of war stories to prove it. Nothing grips my spirit like worry. It's like a spider spinning webs of worry in my mind and tightening the strings. And if it pulls hard enough, it almost draws me, at its worst moments, into fetal levels of fear. I'm sorry to confess such a thing, because I'm a long-tenured Christian who's memorized virtually every verse in the Bible about worry and about peace. But I inherited a stray genetic particle from my mother's side of the family, and that gene sometimes mutates into a germ that wreaks havoc with my nervous system. I remember my mom standing on the porch of our home in Elizabethton, Tennessee, wringing her hands when ambulances raced up Highway 19E in the direction of our apple orchard, 20 miles away. Thousands of people lived up that road, but my mother always worried my dad had suffered an accident. As a child, I anguished over misplaced library books, and my first panic attacks came when I had to give oral reports in school. A set of paralyzed lungs doesn't bode well for someone wanting to become a public speaker. If I had time, I'd tell you about the moment in high school when I barreled through an acute panic attack while on stage, and by God's grace, emerged through the experience with nearly all fear of public speaking gone. But that's another story. Suffice to say, few of my other anxieties have vanished so abruptly. It's tough to get through the social pressures of school, the insecurity of dating and courtship, and the changes required for marriage when you're too insecure to talk to people or risk rejection. One tends to burrow into one's own world. I like it in my own world. I'm an introvert, but not if I'm padlocked in there by worry. I can blame it all on DNA. Worry, which is essentially a strain of fear, is a rational response to real pressures and problems. Life is harder than we expect, and even the Lord Jesus, the Prince of Peace himself, admitted each day has enough trouble of its own. Matthew chapter 6, verse 34. He said, "In this world you will have trouble." John chapter 16, verse 33. On one occasion, he even said, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say?" John chapter 12, verse 27. Our souls are easily troubled. The world and its trials seem to be getting worse. In nearly 40 years of pastoral counseling, I've seen a lot of changes in our culture, and it seems to me we're at a flood stage of angst. People are anxious, and everyone seems increasingly tense and taut. We're overextended, running on empty, and often running late. We're worried and we're weary. One moment we're alarmed about global politics, and the next we're frustrated with a clogged commode or a cranky boss. Stress keeps us on pins and needles from dawn to darkness. Anxiety disorders comprise the most common mental illness in America. Officially, they affect 18% of the adult population, but 100% of us worry about life every day. We fret and fear as we face anxious moments, and there's a strain over everything we do, even when we're having fun. I'm writing these words on a balcony in Naples, Florida, overlooking the Gulf of Mexico. Below me are palm trees, seagulls, a lovely pool, and a placid ocean with soft rhythmic waves. Yet worry never takes a vacation. There's seldom a time when I feel totally free from inklings of fear, and even now, I have a nagging feeling of foreboding about things back home. We need professional counselors, therapists, doctors, and people with giftings of wisdom to help us. Mental illness is treatable at all its levels, and modern science offers helpful solutions. Nutrition, exercise, rest, and good habits make big differences in how we handle stress. Prescribed medication used wisely can play a role in our healing. The right therapists and counselors can be literal lifesavers. But medical treatment alone is incapable of reaching the hidden depths of the soul. We need a house call from the great physician and a good dose of his therapeutic truth. The Bible is our Lord's prescription pad, and meditation helps more than medication. The frequent contemplation of Scripture heals the mind better than the wisest counselor or the newest drug. To steady our minds in the storm, medical and psychological treatment programs must be anchored on a rock that keeps the soul steadfast and sure. As Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9 tells us, the missing pieces for most people are the peace of God and the God of peace. On the following pages, I want to lead you through these verses, for they constitute the Bible's premier passage on the subject of anxiety. This is God's most definitive word about overcoming anxiety and experiencing His overwhelming peace, and that's why it's currently America's go-to passage of Scripture. It's been of great help to me. It's time for you to wage war on worry with the weapons provided in God's unfailing Word. On the basis of Scripture, you can live more, worry less, and give each day a happier turn. You can bury worry before worry buries you. Introduction. In every situation, let me tell you of a man with whom I'm familiar. He was an energetic worker who left home to roam the globe as a spiritual ambassador, a missionary. Traveling to a picturesque corner of the Mediterranean, he came to a port on the Aegean. Beautiful in its setting, famous for its grapes, wine production, and white cheese. Sailors, importers, exporters, students, and philosophers from across Europe and Asia flowed through the gates and harbors of this city, and its population was a melting pot of humanity. Fishermen and financiers were equally at home within its borders. Yet it was a dark place, a city with no spiritual light. It was a city badly needing hope, needing a church. My friend, an experienced missionary strategist, was as dedicated as anyone you've seen. As he explored the neighborhoods of the city, his heart yearned within him, and he instinctively saw the possibilities of launching a meaningful ministry. The city was a virtual open door for humanitarian aid and evangelism. People were searching for some good news, and the missionary could have done a great work there. But alas, it came to naught. Something stopped this man in his tracks, and he abandoned the work before it even started. He left the city abruptly, the work undone, the door unopened. The problem wasn't related to politics or persecution or finances or failing health. There were no issues with his passport or visa, no official objections to his work, no legal challenges, and no bullying. The man simply suffered an anxiety attack triggered by an event far away. And at the moment of greatest opportunity, his emotions were hijacked by a wave of worry that robbed him of his ability to concentrate. He became so obsessed by his distress that he could not function. In a state of jittery panic, the man packed his bags and moved on like a vagabond, unable to focus, unable to pursue his work, unable to find peace, hoping to hear good news further down the line. He later described what happened to him like this. Now when I went to Troas to preach the gospel of Christ and found that the Lord had opened a door for me, I still had no peace of mind because I did not find my brother Titus there. So I said goodbye to them and went on to Macedonia. When we came into Macedonia, we had no rest, but we were harassed at every turn, conflicts on the outside, fears within. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 12 through 13, and chapter 7, verse 5. The missionary who suspended his work in Troas was the Apostle Paul. He grew so worried about the problems in his signature work in distant Corinth that he couldn't zero in on the possibilities in Troas. Paul had expected Titus to meet him in Troas with updates, and he hoped with better news. But Titus never showed up, and Paul couldn't concentrate on the work at hand because of fears within and uncertainties afar. To me, this is a remarkable admission. It shows the human side of a great biblical hero. It indicates the apostle was high-strung, full of nervous energy, and predisposed toward anxiety. He battled fears within as acutely as he battled conflicts on the outside. He's not alone. When a successful actress was recently interviewed by Glamour magazine, the reporter asked her why she was reclusive, why she didn't go out and have more fun, why she seldom partied. The young celebrity replied, "It's sad, actually, because my anxiety keeps me from enjoying things as much as I should at this age." "Really?" said the journalist. "I know a lot of young women suffer from anxiety. It's brave of you to talk about it." The starlet explained, "I take pills, long-term pills. It makes me tired all the time. Anxiety, it just stops your life." Perhaps you know from personal experience how anxiety in its many forms can stop or retard your joy, stamina, enthusiasm, confidence, and wellness in life. Someone defined worry as a small trickle of fear that meanders through the mind and cuts a channel into which all other thoughts are drained. Anxiety is a mode of worry, a load of care, a sense of unease, and a nervous strain that coats our personalities like enamel. It's disquiet and disease in our souls. Sometimes it's nothing more than a flutter or a knot in our stomachs. Other times it manifests itself in panic attacks or post-traumatic stress episodes. Often we're gripped by fistfuls of fear that overwhelm our circuits. According to the New York Times, Americans are among the most anxious people on earth. The Times reported a study by the World Mental Health Survey that found Americans to be the most anxious people in the 14 nations covered by the research. Americans were significantly more anxious than residents of nations like Nigeria, Lebanon, and Ukraine. We spend billions of dollars every year on anti-anxiety medications and additional millions to fund research into the causes and cures for anxiety disorders. One recent study suggested that children who are picky eaters might later be more prone toward anxiety. Another study suggests that stress during childhood can affect the makeup of bacteria in our stomachs and intestines and could influence our mental health and trigger anxiety. Other experts study the relationship between anxiety and genetics. Researchers at the University of Wisconsin-Madison reported that a study of monkeys revealed some of them had a more anxious temperament than others, and the scientists were able to find some hereditary linkage. According to a report in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, about 30% of a human's anxiety can be attributed to inherited factors. That means, the researchers note, that 70% of our anxieties can be affected by changing our outlooks and habits. Time magazine recently devoted its cover story to teenage anxiety, and the headline was, "The Kids Are Not All Right. American teens are anxious, depressed, and overwhelmed." The article pointed out that today's adolescents are the post-9/11 generation, raised in an era of economic and national insecurity. They've never known a time when terrorism and school shootings weren't the norm. They grew up watching their parents weather a severe recession. And perhaps most importantly, they hit puberty at a time when technology and social media were transforming society. One expert said, "If you want to create an environment to churn out angsty people, we've done it." One teenager explained, "We're the first generation that cannot escape our problems at all. We're all like little volcanoes. We're getting this constant pressure from our phones, from our relationships, from the way things are today." The magazine failed to ascribe any blame to secularism with its despair-inducing implications. We've had several generations of children flowing through the pipeline of a secular education system where God and scripture and prayer are treated as banned substances. where the spiritual life of students is non-existent, and where young people are indoctrinated with the hypothesis they are nothing but mutated molecules of primordial sludge that somehow evolved into carbon beings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.